Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to this 11th meeting of the Justice Committee in 2014? Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices completely as the interview of the broadcasting system, even when switched to silent? And apologies have been received from Alison McInnes. Item 1, I want to ask the committee to agree further consideration of a work programme under item 3 in private. Are you agreed?
Agreed.
Item 2, stage 1 evidence continues in the Court Reform Scotland Bill. This is our third day of evidence. We're hearing from two panels of witnesses. The first panel will focus mainly on the provisions of the bill relating to judicial review, though I say to the panel, apart from that, if you want to move on to anything else afterwards, please feel free to comment. Now, welcome to meeting Jonathan Mitchell, QC, Tony Kelly, Chair of the Justice Scotland, and Lloyd Austin, Convener of Governance Forum Scottish Environment Link. I think Mr Gibb of the Scottish Immigration Law Practitioners Association will be joining us later. Can I invite questions from members, please? Sandra, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I just wanted some clarification, maybe some advice from yourselves. I note that originally more people supported the 3 months, you know, basically time limit than were actually against it. And the people who opposed the 3 months and wanted it longer were concerned about the short time scale for legal aid, housing, welfare and immigration. Now, having been involved in a number of cases, we've had to seek judicial review very quickly for immigration and asylum. Could you explain to me why there's concern in regard to those three issues, housing, welfare and immigration, and what would be the problems?
Can you say, if you just indicate to me, I'll call you and your light will come on, your microphone will come on automatically. Jonathan Mitchell, please.
Yep. As you say, there's been a lot of support for having a very short time limit in this area. And I think you have to look back at why it is that people are supporting it as part of an answer to your question. The fact is that the judicial review is how the citizen keeps the state in order. In a sense, it's the civil equivalent of criminal prosecution. If you did a survey in Barlinnie about whether there should be a three-month time limit on prosecution for crime, you get a massive vote in favour. What you've got here is a massive vote by public authorities that they want to be immune from legal action. And that's the whole point of having a three-month time limit, or indeed any restriction on point of time. It is so that if I, as a citizen, see that the state or a local authority is breaking the law, if I don't do anything about it in a fairly short period of time, nothing can be done about it. And I think you can see that very sharply when you see how the provision that's put forward deals with continuing breaches of the law when the grounds first arose. I'll give you a specific example. In 2003, this Parliament voted to bring in a right of appeal for patients under the Mental Health Act who held an excessive security. And it voted that that would be done by the 1st of May 2006. It's never been brought in. That was the subject of a judicial review petition which took 2 years to get into court. It was brought in May of 2008. By 2012, the court had held, and this is the standing order of the court, the government was acting unlawfully in not implementing the right of appeal. By April 2014, nothing has been done, and the statutory provision this Parliament enacted remains not in force. Now, what we have here is something upon which government can then turn round and say to anyone now who brings a case, you weren't in court in 3 months. And coming back specifically to cases like immigration and asylum, it means that if I, as an asylum claimant, have a good claim that I should not be sent back to a country where I say I will be tortured, if I don't bring it within 3 months, then, in effect, I'm just at judicial discretion, because there is a provision for judicial discretion. And it's a matter of my keeping my fingers crossed, if to use the old metaphor, as to whether I'll be allowed to make that complaint. Now, all of this is being done, in effect, because of a claim that it's good public administration that people bring cases as soon as they can. There is no other parallel context in Scotland in which people are held to limits like this. If I have a road accident, I've got 3 years to claim. If I've got a contract claim, I've got 5 years to claim. Even under the Human Rights Act and Scotland Act more generally, I've got a year to claim. 3 months is unique. And one has to ask, why is it being done? And when you say, why are people supporting it, you can see why it's being done. It is to stop people making claims. And the rationale of this is to cut down the very small number of judicial reviews that we have in Scotland at present by making it more difficult for people to get into court. And if it wasn't going to do that, there'd be no purpose in having the provision at all. There'd be no point in this discussion.
How many judicial reviews do we have in Scotland, if you can give those stats?
It goes up and down, obviously, year by year, but as a crude generalisation, approximately 300 to 350 a year for 5 million people. Now, of these, about three-quarters, four-fifths are asylum cases. They're subject to special court procedures, which in effect provide for a more summary form of determination once they're in court. Mm-hmm. We have more or less 50 or 60 judicial reviews a year which are brought by the 5 million people in Scotland, companies and so on, who are not asylum seekers. So it's a tiny number of cases, but nevertheless it's the very sharp end of a very big issue, which is operating the rule of law.
Any other witnesses wish to come? Mr. Kelly first.
Yeah, just a point of information. We have mentioned the figures that are mentioned in the Justice Scotland written submission at page 4.
Yes.
And just in relation to the number of respondents who supported this introduction of a time limit, a note from the Civil Justice Review compiled by Lord Gill, chapter 12, page 38, page 26, he mentions that just over 20% of respondents to his review on this issue consider that a time limit should be introduced. So I don't think there's an overwhelming majority that seek this.
Besides, percentages don't always mean
indeed
what they appear to mean. Do you want to say, Mr. Robson? Yes.
Yes, I'd just like to agree with Jonathan's point about judicial review being the way in which citizens can challenge the state. From our point of view, on behalf of the environment, we're very aware that the environment itself can never go to court. And so in relation to governmental or public body decisions affecting the environment, the EU and the UK and Scotland are signed up to the Aarhus Convention as a means of providing rights of citizens, of communities and of NGOs to seek review of decisions affecting the environment. And one of the issues there is this timing question comes into the right of those bodies. We do agree that there is a preference towards timiousness, but I think in some circumstances where funding is an issue, whether getting legal aid or fundraising by local community groups and so forth, these things mean that before one can go to court, you have quite a few hurdles to cover, and that can take more than 3 months. So I think there is an issue there for local community groups, local campaigning groups, local individuals who are particularly concerned on behalf of the public interest in environmental matters. On the question of numbers, on environmental and planning issues, there's a particularly useful research report produced by Neil Collar, a partner at Brodie's, in terms of the number and the types of judicial reviews in the field of planning, indicating that actually he concludes judicial review is not a NIMBY's charter. Although half the cases are brought by objectors, many of those are actually competitive commercial interests, not necessarily just campaigning groups and so on. So I'd certainly recommend the committee look at that in terms of the numbers.
Well, it'll certainly get the clerks to get a copy of that.
I can leave that
behind. No, I'm coming. It's all right. I'm coming back to you, Sandra.
Just a follow-up question.
I don't know. Yes, no. Please do.
Right?
No, I'm just checking.
Okay,
if
thank you.
You're not
just
on my
follow-up
list, you want
question. As someone who tried to introduce a third-party right of appeal for community groups, obviously, I'm very supportive of groups having that right, unsuccessfully tried to put it forward as a private member's bill.
Days
yes,
when we
it
went
does,
camping
and
for that,
Kavira
yes.
was supportive there as well. We're talking about a 3 months time limit, and as you mentioned before, perhaps it was certain groups that were more supportive than others. If it's not the 3 months time limit, what time limit would you say you would be looking to put on?
Maybe ask
Mr. Kelly, yes.
What we said in our submission was that it's difficult to see why the choice of 3 months was made. The only real reason we can see is that there's a complete read across from England and Wales, and we are in an entirely different situation. England and Wales have a very stringent time limit because of the volume of litigation which basically overran the administrative court down south, and that's why they introduced the time limit, trying to basically rein in the number of applications. We don't have anywhere near, nowhere near approaching a problem in relation to volume. If pressed on a choice, what we said was that perhaps the Human Rights Act and the Scotland Act provides a go-to in relation to assessing where the time limit should be. I wouldn't say it's a well-worn avenue of litigation using the Human Rights Act and the Scotland Act, but at least litigants know that they have 1 year to get to court, and if they don't get to court within 1 year, they're going to have a problem. They're going to have to ask the court to exercise an equitable discretion. So that if pressed, would be an idea. But I think the primary question, the sort of first question, would be why choose 3 months? And there doesn't seem to be a pressing need for 3 months in this jurisdiction.
I think that's right. If we have a time limit at all, then this is incredibly short. And realistically, it means that somebody has got to be teed up and get a solicitor who's teed up really within weeks to be getting the papers in order, to get the case into court through counsel and so on. One has to ask why 3 months when it is so much longer for anything else. But behind that is a deeper question. Why have a time limit on this at all? We don't have a time limit for prosecution of murder. We don't say to people, well, it's just not fair that, you know, this happened 20 years ago. The reason that is put forward for why a time limit is needed is it's to protect proper public administration and the rights of third parties. Now, why do we then, however, say that even if it's not needed for that purpose, that we still have a time limit? I would have thought that what we could have is a completely differently written provision that said, where there's an unfair prejudice to public administration or to third parties, that that's a bar to coming into court. You can see how that could happen in, for example, a planning case, if I want to challenge a grant of planning permission to my next door neighbour when they've built, that sort of thing. Or if I want to challenge a decision on last year's budget for a local authority when we're now going into the next year. But why do we say that the asylum seeker who complains that there's a decision being made which will result in them being sent back to be tortured, that there's a third-party interest there to be defended? There simply isn't. And there's a baby in a bathwater problem here.
Mr. Austin.
Yes. So I think if pressed, we would agree with the human rights comparison of a year being an alternative limit. But I think it's really much more a question of, I would agree with asking the question, why have a limit at all? Why not have a limit that's determined by the circumstances of the case? I mean, if you're challenging a planning decision after the development is built or something like that, that's ludicrous. But, and the circumstances of the individual or the community campaign group or the NGO, how whether they have professional advisors in place at the time of preparing the case, or whether they need to fundraise to pursue the action or not. I would have thought those kind of circumstances should be taken into account in determining the time period that would be determined as timeous.
Thank you. I'll take Margaret, then I've got Roderick, then John Pentland, then John Finney. Margaret.
Good morning, gentlemen. I wonder if you could comment on the leave of court proposals and the two sort of tests, sufficient interest and real prospect of success, apparently being introduced to help filter out unmeritorious cases, although there doesn't seem to be much evidence that there is a problem with unmeritorious cases. Is that the case?
I'm happy to speak to that. There is a pretty low bar at the moment that the court can exert some control over the cases coming in at first order stage. So I'm certainly aware of cases where the judge requires to be addressed upon whether there is a competent application to the supervisory jurisdiction. This would raise it quite considerably. So the petitioner would have to satisfy the court that there are real prospects of success, And I think, again, reading across to England, where there seems to be an analogy again drawn, there the provision is used to weed out vexatious, hopeless, frivolous applications. And certainly we would have no problem with the test being one that would weed out those hopeless cases. But it seems that this is quite a big jump up into placing a real bar. And the problem is that it's linked to the three-month time limit. If people are rushing to get to court to beat the time bar, there's a problem that those applications may well not be as fully prepared and as fully argued, or capable of being fully argued at that stage, and that would leak into the higher test being applied to those perhaps not fully worked up applications. In relation to the other aspect of it, we don't particularly have a problem in relation to standing. That really seeks to codify, I think, what already has been stated by the Supreme Court in relation to standing. Sufficient interest seems incredibly realistic and appropriate.
Mr. Mitchell.
Yes. On the standing point, that's right. The law has been reformed in recent years by the courts, and I think this is recognised by the provision in the bill. On the weeding out, I have to say that I see arguments on both sides on this. Of course, unmeritorious cases should not proceed further, and I don't really have a problem with the idea that should be done at at a very early stage. In fact, there have been reforms in court procedure in the last couple of years which have already brought that into effect without any need for statute, so far as the immigration and asylum cases are concerned, and that was being done as a template for more general internal reform. I think as Professor Kelly says, the problem is how it links in with the time bar. If you have to have all your skittles already up in a neat row within the three-month time limit, it may be quite difficult to, in effect, be able to satisfy a court that this is a case with good prospects. The present situation, in effect, allows you a chance to make sure your skittles are up before somebody tries to knock them down. That said, as I say, I don't really have a problem with the permission provisions as they stand in the bill as such. There is a problem. I don't think it's a big one, but there is a problem with people bringing hopeless cases. It's the fact that it's not big can be seen by success rates. If you look at immigration and asylum, traditionally they've had a success rate of something between 2/3 and 4/5 each year have been successful. We see that by seeing what happens on the expenses. So, and within the minority that don't succeed, yes, there are some cases that should never have been brought. But this is, as was said, it's a lifting from England. In England, the courts get flooded with hopeless cases, a lot of them by party litigants, a lot of them quite unscrupulously. You can tell by our numbers that we do not have a flooding problem. In a way, what we have here is a solution that is searching for a problem. And nobody has identified a problem of unmeritorious cases being brought as big enough to justify litigation. It's brought forward theoretically on the basis that if it's a problem in England, how could it possibly not be a problem here? Statistics show it's not.
Might there be displacement if we have, if there's a time limit in England, there isn't in Scotland, so people would decide, well, I'm going to get to Scotland where I get a longer go at staying?
There could be in theory. There's very few cases, but they do exist, where people can in effect choose which court to bring a case in. There's one or two cases. One, for example, which I was involved in, is the case against the Lord Chancellor to strike down the introduction of fees in the Employment Tribunal, where I act for the petitioners in Scotland and Unison is doing a parallel case in England. So there's a degree of competition, if you like, between the two countries there. They're very rare. The Home Office were asked about this about 2 years ago, about whether they could point to a problem of asylum seekers forum shopping between England and Scotland. They said then in open court they'd researched this and they hadn't found a single case where somebody had done it. But yes, in theory, it's true that if people could come to Scotland after 3 months when they couldn't in England. But so be it. We have that theoretical issue, of course, in everything from divorce to road accident cases.
I thought it worth asking anyway.
No, you're quite absolutely.
A point to make. Yes. Margaret, do you... Sorry, Mr. Austin, then Margaret.
I wonder if Mr. Austin would address Article 9 of the UN Economic Commission on Europe Convention of Access to Information, exit ARIS, I think it's convention that's called.
ARIS, yeah.
Is that how you pronounce it? Okay.
Yes, I'll come to that. But just on the original question, on sufficient interest and standing, we completely agree with the other comments in terms of the decisions the court's made in AXA and Wharton, and we believe that should be continued. On the leave to proceed stage, I think we can see benefits in it subject to certain circumstances, and I think the question as to whether or not how high the hurdle is an important one. I think it's a good process to weed out vexatious cases, but there are cases that may be on the, you know, on the balance that if the test is, you know, a good chance of success, those ones on the balance that would actually benefit from a good argument in substance may get knocked out as well. So I think it's important that balance is put there. The other opportunity that it offers is it offers an opportunity for a first hearing to address some of the sort of preliminary points like protected expenses orders that save people's concerns about costs and settling issues like standing. So that those issues can be addressed before the costs and expenses of the substantive arguments start racking up, and that can have an opportunity to reduce the chilling effect on litigants. The other issue I would mention is this issue of the right to an oral hearing or an appeal if leave is refused. There are circumstances. One of our sister organisations in England and Wales, Friends of the Earth in England and Wales, not in Scotland, took action against Secretary of State for Energy. This was about the home renewables decision. And that was refused leave to proceed initially, but they appealed the leave to appeal stage. And when they had they won that, and at the substantive hearing, they won the case. So I think it's very important that if leave to proceed is refused, there is a right of a hearing or an appeal. On Aarhus, I mean, Aarhus is our key concern in terms of rights of litigants on behalf of the environment. And that it deals with a number of matters, but essentially it says that communities, citizens, NGOs should have a right to have decisions affecting the environment reviewed. And there's a couple of things that the article goes on to say should. So first of all, you have to have sufficient standing, which I think we've now addressed in the sufficient interest test for those citizens and NGOs and communities. But the three tests that are mentioned in the article are issues of timing, issues of not prohibitively expensive, and issues of the merits. And this bill and the discussions about judicial review are addressing issues to do with costs and issues to do with timing, but not issues to do with the substantiveness of the review. And that's an interesting question, because judicial review isn't designed to look at the merits of the case. And therefore, there is a question there as to whether or not you should adapt judicial review to meet the requirements of the Aarhus Convention, or whether you should have a lower court, a tribunal or something on the environment to do that. And as Environment Link, our member bodies support the concept of an environmental tribunal, an environmental court, that could do those substantive reviews. And that could be a chamber within the new unified tribunal system, for instance. And I know the government is committed to reviewing the options for an environmental court. That was in the government's manifesto, and we're looking forward to hearing about those issues when the time comes.
So is there a gap just now, then, in how people can be represented? It's very much a live issue, I think, in Scotland, with incinerators being and biomass being objected to by huge numbers in various communities Scotland-wide.
Yes, I would argue it is a big issue that individuals, communities and NGOs have a number of hurdles to overcome in order to raise environmental questions that we would argue are perfectly valid And those hurdles illustrate, in our opinion, non-compliance with the Aarhus Convention, whether that's to do with the right to a substantive review, whether it's to do with the thing being prohibitively expensive because of the non-application or the high level of costs, and to do with whether or not they may be frozen out by the time limit we've just been discussing.
Thank you.
Roderick, followed by John Pentland, then John Finney. Roderick.
Morning, panel. Could I just refer to my register of interest, a member of the Faculty of Advocates? If I may, I'd just like to come back on a couple of points that have already been raised. One is the question of standing. You referred to the decision of the Supreme Court in the AXA case. Obviously, since then, the Inner House has considered matters further in the Sustainable Shetland case, and reached a view that in that case, Donald Trump in particular may have been affected by the issues in the petition, but not directly affected, taking on board some of the comments made in the Supreme Court that for anyone to wish to enter the process, they must be directly affected. Are you all content that the question of whether or not someone's directly affected is a matter that can be determined by the courts? Or is this not an opportunity in legislation to consider that more fully?
Mr. Mitchell.
Yeah. I think that's right, that although the law itself is now in a perfectly good shape and perfectly clear, that there's a certain degree of uncomfortableness, it seems to me, with those who operate it, both in the courts and in government, in recognising that. Sustainable Shetland is an example, and that there's been a steady flow, not very many cases, but certainly enough to show that there's a little bit of a problem with people claiming that it's a good defence to a case, that somebody does not have a sufficient interest, because although it affects the public generally, it does not affect the individual. And there are a number of examples. The one I mentioned about the challenge to the non-introduction of the appeal right for mental patients was successfully challenged by Scottish ministers all the way through the Court of Session upon the basis that because the right had not been introduced, how could the person concerned claim that his rights were being affected because he didn't have any rights in the first place? Ha ha! Good point, one would have thought, for a school debating society, but it actually succeeded in the Court of Session twice before being knocked out in the Supreme Court. There are other examples. The Employment Tribunal's fees example, it was accepted by HM government, by the Lord Chancellor in England, that there was a sufficient public interest for this to be litigated. But in Scotland, the point was taken, albeit it was thrown out by the court, that there was no sufficient public interest for people to challenge this, that the only people who could challenge this were individuals who'd been stopped from raising a case, with the consequence that until the scheme had been brought into force, nobody could challenge it. So there is a continuing undercurrent, you're quite right, about people raising problems about standing. I think the difficulty that we have, though, is that this is a cultural difference. It's not a legal problem. And it's healthy that that Parliament should, in effect, give a rubber stamp of approval, as it does in this provision, to the law as it has been declared by the Supreme Court.
Okay.
Mr. Rawson?
Yes, I mean, I'd agree with that. I think the case in AXA, is the law from AXA is clear, but I'd agree that there are issues and debate about its application. And I'd just refer back to what I said earlier about environmental cases or cases where the challenge is about a decision affecting the environment. Is the environment can't go to court. So if you take the directly affected phrase and you apply it to an individual who's acting on behalf, an individual, a community or an NGO, acting on behalf of the environment, then you can always argue that they're not directly affected because they're not acting on behalf of themselves. They're acting on behalf of the public interest, which is deemed to be environmental concerns. And so I think that's one of the reasons why the UN, in passing and in promoting the Aarhus Convention, has said that here is a public interest that we want to see having a say through individuals, through community groups, through NGOs and so on, that can't litigate itself, and therefore we want to see some form of ability for others to do it on its behalf. And that's an issue that the application of the ACSA test sometimes does raise.
Just very briefly, I think I would echo what Mr. Mitchell says. It's difficult to be prescriptive on the face of the bill. I think the terms of the provision are probably as far as it can go. And I think there is a cultural difference between litigation about the public interest up here as against down south. There's a wealth of litigation where the English courts are actually sort of more open. They say this is not about a busybody litigating for the sake of it. This is someone who's bringing a wrong before the court to have it clarified and have the interest declared. And up here, we seem to have traditionally taken a very narrow view of that. Even whenever the law appeared to have been freed up, the Court of Session took a very narrow view in ACSA, and that again had to be opened up again and declared afresh. And I think what you're saying probably in the Sustainable Shetland case is yet again yet a narrow view being taken of that by the courts. I think it's difficult to widen it up on the face of the bill. Probably what you would then basically do is deprive the courts of any gatekeeper role at all in relation to the question of standing. So we're content with the terms of the bill as it is.
Okay, just to clarify that. If I could that's also just roll back a bit to the time limits point. The bill provides that a period of 3 months or such longer period as the court considers equitable having regard to all the circumstances. We're a bit confused, Mr. Kelly, from Justice's written submission on that, because it seemed to imply there was no equitable jurisdiction.
Read that.
Just ask you for your further thoughts on that, and also moving on to the question about the time being calculated from the date grounds for judicial review first arise. Can you just perhaps the panel deal with both of those points?
Well, first I'll let Mr. Kelly deal with the specific one, then the broader point, the whole panel.
I accept. I mean, I read that in our submission with a bit of surprise. There clearly is an equitable part.
Submission with a bit of surprise. Is your name at the bottom of it?
Is indeed. Is
dearie
indeed.
Me.
So there clearly is an equitable power given to the court. I think in terms of subparagraph B, the problem I think that we have is that the 3 months is the headline time limit. That becomes the default. Certainly, that's what happened in England. That becomes the default, and we have to then come to court in even a day after 3 months and try to basically persuade the court to exercise that equitable discretion. We do have a problem, and we've explained that in our submission, we do have a problem in relation to the assessment of when the time starts, and that has a problem in relation to continuing breaches or a course of conduct. And those are the sort of problems that the court always deals with some difficulty in relation to calculation of time limits. And the commencement of the time period in terms of the bill is the date on which the grounds giving rise to the application first arise. And that would mean that if a policy is in place, Mr. Mitchell has given you an example, the one that came to mind whenever I looked at it was in relation to the question of, say, slopping out. Now, that first arose back in the 60s. It became justiciable in terms of the convention under the Scotland Act in 1999. Now, when would we start saying that first arose? Would we say that in relation to terms of individual litigants? If they don't get to court within 3 months of their incarceration, did it first arise for them? But we have a continuing course of conduct and something that was brought to court and was reviewed and was held to be a proper and sound judicial review. And there's all sorts of problems that are inherent in the calculation of that time limit commencing whenever the grounds first arise. One can even see, dare I say it, before the committee in relation to judicial review of acts of the Scottish Parliament. If there are sound reasons, I don't say that there are in all cases, but there are sound reasons for judicially reviewing an act of the Scottish Parliament as being beyond the devolved competence of the Parliament, if that a challenge doesn't get to court within 3 months of that being brought into force, if that suddenly occurs to someone 4 months after the commencement, the litigant's got a problem because the grounds first arose whenever the Act came into force.
Rawson.
Yes, I think the question about when the grounds arose is one that actually underlines the need for greater flexibility on time limits. There are many cases relating to local people or communities or campaign groups where they didn't actually know about a decision at the time the decision is made, and it may take a couple of months before they realise what the impact on their local environment is going to be. And then they organise themselves and start fundraising and so on. So I think that does underline the need for greater flexibility on time limits from our point of view.
Can I add to that? Across the board, as a generalisation, and there are exceptions, knowledge that you have something you can go to court about is usually a necessity before time starts to run. If I've been in a road accident, but I don't actually know who it was who ran into me, time isn't running until I can reasonably know who that is. The more general problem, however, which I think is important, is that superficially it's quite right to have the fallback provision that the court can deal with this equitably. I think the problem is when you ask how is this going to work in practice, because with a tight time limit, this is going to be getting argued constantly. Now, I do work for respondents just as much as I do for petitioners. And what I am going to do in this is I'm going to advise clients that here is a good case, a good case being brought against them, and that they're going to lose it if the court actually hears it on its merits. And so what we should do is give our attention to saying that it's not equitable, it should be allowed to be brought in the first place. And you're going to get satellite litigation, and in a lot of cases it's going to be complete duplication. First we have an argument about whether it's equitable that the case should be brought, and then after it's got through, we're then going to have an argument about whether it's a well-founded case. And that's isn't too much of a problem if it was only happening from time to time. But with such tight time limits, it's going to happen constantly.
I assume that the panel is of agreement that whatever the time scale provided, however, you'd still want to have a backstop equitable provision in any event.
Absolutely.
But that it would be used less often if the time scale, the original time scale, was much wider.
Yeah. The other thing to say about the timescale, the timescale is that it encourages people to get to court as the first reaction. When, to look down south, they have a pre-action protocol that one must follow as a petitioner before you get to court. And having this sort of blanket provision and a stringent provision in the face of the bill means that people will go to court and then turn round to try to find information, try to deal with the respondent. If you have a more generous time limit and perhaps coupled with a pre-action protocol of some sort, then you have communication with the respondent. You might have an elucidation of a particular bit of information that completely deprives you of your right of action, that clears it up, or you might have a concession, and that avoids the necessity of court action.
I completely accept Mr. Mitchell's point about knowledge. I just would be concerned about sometimes the narrow interpretation of a local community or a local individual being deemed to know something. And in that regard, I'd refer to the McGuinty case about the Hunterston planning decision, where he was unable to challenge that National Planning Framework decision because he was deemed to be aware of the consultation that took place, which was advertised in the Edinburgh Gazette and wasn't locally
Edinburgh,
exactly. So I think the narrow interpretation of he should have known, it does have a concern to local people and local communities.
Thank you.
Thank you, Roderick. John Pentland, followed by John Finney.
Obviously, the Gill report is recommending the three-month short time limit. Could you maybe tell me, given that there is diverse areas of policy which can form the basis of a judicial review action, do you believe that a one-size-fits-all should be, or do you believe that perhaps there should be a single time limit for all types of cases?
I think it's pretty difficult to have a facts and circumstances time limit. I think that's the problem that prompted the provision. We have a very sort of loose and vague time limit of mora, and the difficulty has been the application of that varies according to the facts and circumstances. So we're not opposed to the introduction of a time limit, and it would be one that says this is it. This is whenever you get into difficulty and you have to invoke the equitable discretion of the court.
Which is 1 year, I think you said.
If pressed, I would say 1 year because right. It's one that we're conversant with. But
definitely the one size fits all for us is not 3 months.
I think you're right that it's a bit odd. I mean, judicial review covers such a wide range of possible issues. And the one extreme, just a challenge to something which is national, a planning policy nationally. At the other extreme, it's the single asylum claimant. And one line which I think runs through this, which one could turn into a proper statutory provision, is to say that there's a time limit where to allow people to bring a case would cause, I'm saying the precise words off the top of my head, but you can, the draftsman could formulate it, an unreasonable prejudice to public administration or the rights of third parties. And we gave the examples, the planning permissions and the like, and I'm sure there's plenty of others. But that is, if you like, a two-sizes-fits-all sort of provision. There's the ones where you have to look at people at third parties' rights or the general interests of the public, and the ones which are the vast majority where you don't, where it's really just a citizen complaining that they've been affected by illegal acts of the state, or that the public has been affected by illegal acts of the state, using the state in its widest sense. But this three-month provision says nothing about whether there's prejudice, nothing about whether there's a problem for third parties at all.
Yes, wish to. Thank you.
Can you follow up?
Yes, John.
I wonder if I could then ask the panel, do you think that perhaps a time limit might discourage efforts for cases to be settled, especially when there's legal aid involved?
Certainly, that's what I alluded to, is that the very stringent time limit means that people's first reaction is to get to court within the time limit. That's the reaction, instead of, first of all, let's find out more about this. For example, if you're on the eve of the time limit, you would get to court and then turn round to the respondents and seek further information about the basis of the decision. Then that might mean that the application to the court disappears. But it's much better if there's a more generous time limit, that's canvassed before we go to court, that the petitioner's position is put to the respondent and an opportunity given for them to either think about it and reconsider, concede, or for them to provide further information in relation to the basis of the decision that's under review.
Mr. Austin?
Yes, I'd agree with that. And actually, the procedures down south about letters before action, or whatever they're called, do enable people to sort of get information and or get amendments to decisions that then address their concerns. And if the time limit, whatever it is, starts before those processes, that means that you have to then end up in court and then negate those negotiations or discussions. So I think some opportunities, a longer time limit would enable better discussions between parties.
And just adding to that, I make my living out of people litigating. So my selfish interest is that the more people who jump into court fast, the better. But from a public point of view, this is bad. Litigation ought to be seen as a last resort, not as a first one. And certainly my normal advice to clients is think twice, three times, four times before you go into court. Now, these provisions mean that I won't say that. I'll say jump in fast.
Right, John.
Thank you, Convener. I had a series of questions for Mr. Austin, which Margaret covered, and they've been. But maybe if I could just clarify a few things around costs with you, Mr. Austin. You made mention of the McGuinty case, and I'm looking at evidence we have here, a written submission from Friends of the Earth and the Environmental Law Centre for Scotland, where in relation to, they say in a quote here, in response to legal action from the European Commission, the government's moves to tackle the excessive cost of environmental litigation are limited to codification of the rules of court for PEOs. And going on to say, however, the new rules in Scotland apply only to cases under Public Participation Directive and fall short of providing the kind of assurance against prohibitive expense required by the Aarhus Convention. There's further mention over the page, again, about what may or may not be reasonable in quotes about median salaries across the UK. Are you satisfied that this legislation as laid out, is Aarhus Convention compliant?
The legislation, this bill, doesn't make Scotland Aarhus compliant. No, definitely. In some places, it takes steps towards compliance. In other areas, it doesn't. And I think costs is one of the issues that the Friends of the Earth and Environmental Law Centre have rightly raised as one of the areas where it doesn't fully address the situation.
And is there any particular aspect to this bill that could be altered in some way to make it more compliant?
I think some of the issues to do with time limits and standing that we've discussed before would do that. I think if some of these cost issues could be addressed, that would make us more compliant. But there is still the very significant issue of the right to review of the merits of a decision, which this bill doesn't address, and I don't think this bill could ever address. I think that's a question that has to be done under the government's proposed review of the options of environmental courts or environmental tribunals, which the government is committed to publishing before the end of this parliament. This bill does go and make a few tentative steps towards Aarhus compliance, but it's but the bill on its own will never do everything.
The Aarhus Convention has featured in a lot of the legislation that we've had cause to examine. Do you believe there's a commitment from the Scottish Government to seek compliance with it? Well, I'm actually talking about the Scottish Government.
Yeah. I mean, all governments within the UK are required to comply with the Aarhus Convention. In fact, all governments within the EU are required to comply with the Aarhus Convention because the EU is a party. Nobody from any government, I think, has said we are not going to comply. I think what they have is a different interpretation, a narrower...
Diplomatic answer, Mr. Austin, yes.
I think they have a narrower interpretation of what compliance means than we do.
Mr. Mitchell.
Point. I think Mr. Austin was addressing the British government and not the Scottish government, because the question about an environmental court or an environmental chamber is not something which is applicable in Scotland. Yeah. As far as I know, the UK government has obviously its jurisdiction here, but we're not talking about the Scottish government. The point about expenses, one missed opportunity here is to introduce the Aarhus rule for protective expenses orders in public interest litigation, which government in Scotland has been humming and hawing about for a good few years. Aarhus and European law has introduced a degree of protection for environmental claims against excessive expenses orders, and we really ought to have the same for public interest litigation in general.
Commitment I was referring to was the Scottish Government one. It's in the SNP manifesto, and
the SNP is more than I've done.
And the Cabinet Secretary for the Environment has said that they intend to publish that options paper on an environmental paper before the end of this Parliament.
Sorry. I wonder, given the review that we're looking at and the suggestion of greater specialisms, if there's an opportunity to have an environmental court set up on the back of this legislation?
Yes, I think one of the options the Cabinet Secretary will probably consider is whether there should be an environmental chamber in the new, broader tribunal system.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Christian.
Yes, thank you, Commander. Just a little clarification. I heard all your answers this morning, but I'm still not sure of which way we are going regarding the time limit. Is a shorter time limit going to discourage or encourage the number of judicial review? I've heard conflicted views.
I think the short time limit that the bill introduces will discourage communities and individuals. It will freeze them out. There'll be a chilling effect.
He's asking for what would your time limit be if we can just sum up? Well, I know what Mr. Kelly has told us.
I think if pressed, we would go for a year, as has been said by others. But we are very aware that there are different circumstances in different types of judicial reviews, and I would support Mr. Mitchell's idea of having some criteria by which those circumstances could be interpreted.
Mr. Mitchell.
If I may,
Mr. Mitchell, answer that, and I'll come back, Christian. Mr.
I think the answer is you've got pulls in both directions. As Mr. Kelly said, you're going to have some people who will jump into court early because it's their only chance, and they know that it's their only chance. And these are people who otherwise would have settled matters amicably without going to court at all. You're going to have other people who simply won't get into court at all for a number of reasons. Now, it's a matter of complete speculation, because there has been no attempt to obtain evidence on this, which is, was pointed out by Professor Mullen, is actually quite easily obtainable in the Court of Session records, as to what are the problems of delay and what are the problems of people coming into court slow. I have to say that my guess is that the first group is going to be relatively small. The second group is going to be relatively large. There's going to be a lot of people who will see a solicitor after 6 months of correspondence with a local authority and just be told, well, I'm sorry, but you've missed your chance. But there's not going to be all that many in the first group who are going to jump into court first. But when I say that, that's guesswork, because we have set our face as a system against obtaining real evidence of whether there is a problem, and we have preferred to deal with this. I say we, Scotland, have set our face against getting evidence of what actually happens in practice here.
You wanted to.
It was just, but the answer I was looking for is discouraging when be the answer. That's your guess answer. Thank you.
And finally, as some of the TV shows say, and finally, is there, do you wish to make any comment on any other part of the bill? Please don't feel obliged, because I think it's been very interesting to have your specialist views on judicial review.
No, I have nothing to add, no.
I make a general point. We don't. I say this with a selfish interest, in a sense. We don't have enough judicial review in Scotland. It's extraordinary that a country of 5 million people, if you exclude the asylum seekers, can only generate about 50 or 60 or 70 judicial reviews a year. People do not use the law enough to challenge state unlawfulness.
I'll take it you're not touting for business there. I appreciate that is a disinterested point.
No, I act against as much as I do
for
them.
I understand.
Yes.
Mr. Austin.
I would simply underline the point I made earlier about the environment not being able to litigate on its own and the rights of citizens to challenge decisions affecting the public interest in environmental protection is crucial. And I think judicial review is part of that, but as discussed with Mr. Finney just now, it's not the only thing. And I think efforts beyond this bill are going to be equally important in ensuring those rights.
You've made your pitch for the Tribunal for Environmental Matters. We heard it. Can I thank you all very much? That ends this session. I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes. Take you up till 11 o'clock. Thank you very much. Now move on to our second panel of witnesses, which will focus mainly on delivery of the provisions in the bill. And I welcome meeting Lindsay Montgomery, Chief Executive Scottish Legal Aid Board, Eric McQueen, Chief Executive Scottish Court Service, Sheriff Principal Mary Stephen, a member Roddy Flynn, Secretary, and Ondine, Ondine Tennant, Deputy Secretary of the Scottish Civil Justice Council. And as you know, we move straight on to questions. And if you just indicate to me if you want to come in, I'll call you and your microphone will come on automatically. Elaine.
We have had evidence in previous sessions from other witnesses suggesting...
Before we start, do you mind if your photograph is taken? And then it will be used against you in evidence. Is that all right?
Say no.
You can? Just briefly, though, Andrew, if you're doing it, not too much, because it makes a noise. Right, thank you.
Okay, right. We've had evidence from other witnesses previously suggesting that the sheriff courts at the current time are having difficulty in coping with all the business which is coming their way, in particular that civil cases, such as family cases and so on, are being pushed back. The bill seems to propose that additional work will come the way of the sheriff courts, but there's no additional resource really coming in the same direction. So my first question really was whether or not you believe that the sheriff court can actually cope with this additional work without additional resources coming to
capacity. Yes, Ms. Stephen.
Yes, good
sheriff
morning.
Sheriff Stephen, beg your pardon. Sheriff Principal Stephen, beg your pardon again.
That's quite all right. Thank you very much. And it's a pleasure to be here, not just representing the Civil Justice Council, which is the first statutory manifestation of the court reform, and that is a very good thing, but also as Sheriff Principal, I can perhaps answer the question from a practical point of view. The whole focus of the GIL review, of which I was a member, was to deal with this very problem of criminal business pushing to one side the very important civil business of the court. And the recommendations in the review are very much designed to deal with that. So it is not really a good idea to look at the courts as they are at the present time. The whole reform programme, which is a series of interconnected measures, is designed to not isolate, but to give civil business its place, to put criminal business, and particularly summary criminal business, which is big volume, to the summary sheriff, and to free up sheriffs to play them to their strengths, and that is as lawyers to deal with civil business in a more focused, case-managed and specialised way. So I am confident that the reforms in this bill will significantly change the way that sheriff court business is conducted, and it will give the whole system the opportunity to deal with civil business and increase civil business in a much more effective manner.
Yes, Mr. Before I take a supplementary, wish to comment?
Just in terms of actual physical capacity, you know, we're not just looking at this in isolation. I mean, this has been part of the work as a court service we've been doing over the last couple of years, and the work we've done in shaping Scotland's court services was very much about how do we get the court structures right for the new reforms, how do we make sure we invest in technology and services, and how do we make sure it's affordable in the long term. And I think the Court Reform Bill is the next fundamental milestone in that journey that of reform and change that will happen for the last 5 to 10 years, next 5 to 10 years. There's been a lot of graphic language used, I think, about some of the issues in the court in terms of capacity. And I think it's important to think about physical capacity and also the resources as to how they're deployed. 3 or 4 years ago, we run on an annual basis over 31,500 sitting days within the sheriff courts. At the moment, that figure is just under 29,000. So even allowing for the courts that are now closing, which to a certain extent is supplemented by the capacity coming back from the High Court, there's still over 2,000 court sitting days which we were using in the past, which we're currently not using at the moment. So the issue about physical capacity is actually less of an issue. I think the point about resources and deployment of resources is perhaps one of the more key things, because quite clearly resources have reduced, partly because of the economic crisis, but also partly because of reducing business volumes in recent years. one of the things that civil courts reforms is doing is not actually about bringing new business per se in terms of large amounts, but actually looking at how we redistribute that in a different way. So actually it's about dealing with the same levels, making sure we deploy the same levels of staff and judicial resource at the moment, but actually, as your principal says, to do it in a much more effective and a much more efficient way in the future. And that's what we certainly think that the civil reforms will help us take down that road.
Mr. Montgomery.
I think there are two points I'd pick up there. Firstly, apart from the bill, the huge range of work being done through the Making Justice Work Project and the work that's been done by the Civil Justice Council really should make civil business much more efficient than it is just now. And we would expect to see real benefits in terms of the reduction cost for legal aid coming through those. The second one is, with the exception of civil legal aid, the reductions in civil business through the courts have been very marked and are continuing. In fact, legal aid is only a growth area for a number of reasons. But these two things together, we think, will make a marked difference over the forthcoming years in terms of the management of the business. And from our point of view, therefore, the cost that we pick up for a very large number of cases.
Yeah. Yes. I just wanted, going back to what the Sheriff Principal said, when the Sheriffs came a couple of weeks ago, they suggested that these reforms shouldn't be looked at as something which was happening now, but it was going to happen over a period of years. In terms of the resource of the summary sheriffs, my understanding is that a summary sheriff will only be appointed when another sheriff retires, and therefore you're not actually getting any additional support. And how long do you think it will be before the court system actually settles down and is operating in this new and enlightened way?
Yes, whoever, Mr. Rabin, first.
Our planning assumption is that to move to what we might see as being what could be described the optimum level of summary sheriffs could take anywhere between 5 and 10 years, because quite clearly most of it will be dependent on retired profile of existing sheriffs, and for the vast majority, I think you're correct, it will be on that one-to-one basis. So we expect to see probably a slightly higher number in the first year, because clearly the stipendiary magistrates will transfer over, there will be a number of retirements during that first year. After that, probably a steady state of maybe around about 10 each year incrementally coming in until we get to the level which at the moment we reckon will be round about 60 summary sheriffs at the future. At the same time, though, I think this is the one issue that's been forgotten, is that there will also be a transfer of resource from the Court of Session at the moment to facilitate the work that will be done in the specialist courts in future. So where we create the Sheriff's Appeal Court, where we create the Personal Injury Court, we have a deployment of temporary judge resources at the moment, which will, in future, that resource will be reallocated to those specialist courts as are set up. So the numbers of some of sheriffs in future to sit on those specialised courts would be in addition to just a simple one-to-one exchange that we'll see over the longer term.
And, we've got other legislation coming through, like the Criminal Justice Bill. If that goes through in its current form, there will also be additional criminal work if corroborated. The requirement for abolition is abolished, then there's likely to be more cases coming through. I mean, is this all this factored into your calculations in terms of the workload of the courts?
And I think it's a point that Lindsay commented on earlier, that a lot of the part of the reform is actually about dealing with cases quicker and more effectively. So yes, there's some things that may happen that may increase the resource. Equally, what we are hoping is there will be other things that will balance that resource. But like all of these things, they'll need to be kept under review, and where we are at the moment will need to be reviewed as we go forward in future years.
What increase in criminal cases have you factored in if the requirement for mandatory corroboration goes?
Estimates are based on anywhere around about 6 and 8% at the moment, based on research that was done between both the police and Crown Office.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to? Sheriff Principal, yes.
I would like to say about the transitional arrangements, it's generally thought that it may take about 10 years for the system to roll fully into place. However, it is very important to realise that the bill underpins a very important set of changes that have already begun, namely that people should not simply be litigating at will and in the manner they think appropriate that the ethos now is that the cases will be carefully case managed and also that the court will control the pace and procedure of the litigation rather than, as has been in the past, the parties will simply decide whether they want to proceed quickly to prove or exactly what they want to do. Now, that can be expensive for litigants and also expensive for the resources of the court. So the clear message is that the court will case manage civil litigation and effectively thereby control the procedure, which I think is very important. And that is entirely underpinned by the bill, and the Civil Justice Council are in the process of considering rules to implement that ethos.
Just, can I just, for the sake of the record, just if you'd expand on case manage, does that mean, you know, in documentary sense, and going through documents and processes, that it would also mean sheriffs being much more interventionist with cases? And I'm thinking of Judge Judy, not particularly, but, you know, something like that, just saying, well, banging heads together a bit, as Sheriff Wood would have it, although gently, if I recall his words.
Yes, indeed. At all levels, at the summary or simple procedure level, also in commercial cases where the commercial sheriff will deal with a case management hearing by video conference or telephone and say, right, I've got your case and the defence. What you really mean are the issues are X and Y, not all of the peripheral matters. Can we agree documents? Can we agree part of this case? And can we home in on what it is you actually want the court to decide and not simply let cases gather moss as they go on towards a hearing and the hearing is at large and people stray all over the place and into the long grass?
Mm-hmm. I'm putting moss and long grass together, but I get your drift.
Just finally, there's also been some concerns raised about the IT systems currently in the court system and whether, in fact, they need to be upgraded. The financial memorandum only allocates about £10,000 to that. Do you think that's, are there sufficient resources being allocated to development of IT?
Absolutely. I think it's probably best if I cover that. Again, going back to Shaping Scotland's court services, one thing we were very clear about is that we had to make substantial upgrades and investment in ICT, and it's probably an area where, being honest, has been underfunded in recent years. So quite separate from the court reform bills, what we are anticipating is quite a significant progress in improvement of our ITC capability over the next 2 years and beyond. During the next course of the next year, we will be investing something in the region of about £2.5 million, essentially installing a new network infrastructure, upgrading all our video conference equipment across the network, making sure that we have courts that are kitted with the right equipment to give the right level of evidence presentation, and putting in place our initial building blocks for moving to new case management systems that will allow electronic registration, electronic payment of fees, electronic submissions of motions, so that we can start to move, particularly in the early period, the civil business away from the very, very paper-orientated system it is at the moment, to one that is much more based on technology in the future. So the costs that were in the financial memorandum are only the very small parts that are specific to the Courts Reform Bill. The major part of the investment is already underway, and that's part that's already been agreed by the SCS Board and is in budgets for the next 2 years. And this was a big part of our spending review submission to Scottish Government to make sure that we had the right foundations in place, that IT and digital delivery will lie at the heart of what we do in future.
Thank you. Margaret, followed by Sandra, followed by Broderick.
Just to go on that point a little bit further, I believe a lot of the costs of this are going to be met by court fees. Do you think it's justified that that court users, rather than the public purse, should be paying for the court reform?
Yeah, I mean, certainly the view of government and successive governments for a long time now has been that civil litigation should be funded by the parties that are involved. And that's the whole premise that civil court fees have been based on for certainly as long as I can remember.
At the moment, the court fees in Scotland chargeable are currently round about 40 million. We collect, in terms of hard cash, about 22 million a year. 9 million of those are exemptions, where people, because of their levels of earnings, don't actually pay the civil court fees. And there's probably about another 8 million which is currently unfunded. So there's already quite a big part of the civil court fees, either through exemptions or the areas where we're not yet at full cost recovery, that are getting met by the public purse. What we would see in future, which I think supports Scottish Government policy, is that we move much closer to a position of full cost recovery while maintaining those exemptions. So a big part of the work we'll be doing over the coming year is to try and look at real detail of what the cost of the new civil reform system is going to be, and coming back to Scottish Government so they can come on a consultation and subsequent orders to Finance Committee to look at what civil court fees should be in the future.
So if you don't have any concerns about access to justice and court fees being prohibitive, have you covered the scenario that the court fees may not cover all the costs, and in which case what alternatives are put in place to make sure that the cost of the reforms can be covered?
I mean, the cost of reforms in terms of the major investments that are now underway are now part of our core funding. The fee bill that went through in December last year included an overinflation amount to kick-start some of the funding that was required for court reforms. So the Civil Justice Council, the creation of the team for the Rules Council and some of the early IT works were already part of that fee order that went through. The actual reality is that our funding comes through two streams. One part of it is core funding from Scottish Government allocated through the budget bill, and the other part of the funding comes through civil court fees. At the end of the day, that's a decision for Scottish Government and ultimately a decision for Parliament in terms of what their policy will be on fee recovery. Quite clearly, to run the court service, we need a sum of money, and it has to come from one of those two areas. And I say ultimately Parliament will decide on it.
So there's no other contingency plan on the part of the Scottish Court Service?
Well, there's no other contingency plan, because what we are working through is to make sure we can put in place the most cost-effective and the most efficient court service that Parliament has asked for. That will come with a cost. We don't expect it to be a cost that is additional to the cost of running the service at the moment, and that will be a view taken by Parliament in terms of how that funding is provided.
If I could ask maybe Sheriff Principal Stephen, as part of the Gill Review, what research was carried out and evidence gathered to justify the threshold being set at £150,000?
It was rather difficult to get credible data on settlement figures, because these are figures that are private to the parties. We know about the court judgments, but these are a very, very small proportion of the cases that go to court. Certain data was provided to the researchers. However, it was decided that the exclusive competence limit or the privative limit had to be sufficiently robust and sufficiently high to avoid, indeed, the inflation of the sum sued for in a particular action. Because in a sense, it matters not what the case settles for in the end of the day, But where the case goes to in the court system depends upon what figure is selected by the pursuer to bring it into court. And that can relate to the true value of the case, or it can be considerably and well inflated above the actual value of the case, particularly in personal injury actions.
So is it fair to say it was a guesstimate in part?
Well, it wasn't indeed a guesstimate, but it was based upon the actual information that was available, the number of cases, the number that went to proof, and the settlement statistics that we were able to gain from, in particular, personal injury cases.
In terms of personal injury cases, the court is set to be situated in Edinburgh. I think there are still some concerns about the capacity of work and the volume of work going through the Edinburgh Court as it is. And with Haddington due to close, are there any concerns about how the personal injury court will work, and is there any indication of where the court will sit and who will be actually in the judiciary sitting in it?
I have no concerns about a national or specialised personal injury court in Edinburgh, whether it be in Edinburgh Sheriff Court or in other court estate in Edinburgh. Edinburgh has a specialised personal injury court, and three sheriffs operate in that court. They don't operate full time because there's no need for them to do so, but there are specialised sheriffs who already operate in that context, and I have no concerns about having an effective personal injury court. There would obviously have to be rules and judicial training on civil jury trials, because I think the last civil jury trial in the sheriff court was at the beginning of the 1980s, so obviously none of the sheriffs will have direct experience other than as practitioners in the Court of Session.
And another point raised with other panels was by looking at the value of a case, and a lot of store has been set by that, doesn't necessarily look at the complexity of a case, and there was some concern that cases, because of their complexity, that might otherwise have gone to the Court of Session will now be heard there, and there will be a knock-on effect to the development of Scotland's law. Do you have any comments on that particularly?
The only comment I can make is that the monetary value is the most practical way of determining in which court and system of rules the case is heard. Likewise, in the proposed simple procedure, there can be great complexities in cases of less than £5,000, but nevertheless, that issue has to be tackled if the complexity arises. And there are provisions, and between the Sheriff Court and the Court of Session, you're probably referring to, there's a sort of double lock procedure to get yourself out of the Sheriff Court to the Court of Session. The sheriffs would not have an interest in retaining a case which has genuine complexity or novelty, which deserves a decision from the Court of Session. But the sheriffs are sufficiently experienced to decide these cases and make law. And I think it has to be put in context that many, many personal injury cases are raised. Less than 2% actually see a disputed proof or require a decision by a sheriff or a judge in the end of the day. There will be intermediate motions that require to be dealt with, but these are dealt with daily in our personal injury court, and I have no difficulty whatsoever about envisaging important cases being dealt with in the PI court.
Montgomery wants to come in. Ms. Montgomery.
Quite a significant number of high-value cases are already done in the Sheriff Court. And I'll just give you some legal aid figures. In the last 3 years, we've granted almost 1,400 grants for Sheriff Court cases where the monetary value was in excess of £50,000, so well above the £5,000 that applies in the Court of Session. Of those, over 400 of them were more than 150,000. Over the same 3 years, in terms of medical negligence and reparation, over 100 cases were granted. And of those, over 30 of them were more than £150,000. So a significant percentage of cases are already in the Sheriff Court for these much higher value cases.
Did these cases have counsel?
Of the 1,400, 90% do not have or have not had yet. Some of the more recent ones may get there. Of the 104 of the medical negligence and reparation, 70% of those have not sought or got counsel. A lot of the cases are done by solicitors. Equally, there are some very complex cases which can be at lower value, and we will grant sanction for counsel in those cases.
Just maybe to ask you about the threshold, the sheriffs were very definitely of the opinion that not all the cases should move in one go if the 150,000 threshold was maintained, and it should be staggered. Do you have a view on that?
Sorry, I didn't hear the first part.
The sheriffs were very definitely of the opinion that if the 150,000 threshold remained, not all the cases should transfer in one go, and they should be staggered. Do you have a view on that?
Only to the extent that if the courts are able to cope with the numbers of cases, I don't see any real reason for not doing it at one time, given that a significant number of the cases are already in the Sheriff Court at these higher value.
So
and the point that Sheriff Principal Stephen makes, an awful lot of personal injury and reparation cases settle.
So you have no concerns about it all moving?
Not from, from our point of view.
If I may say, I'm perhaps not understanding what the sheriff said or what your question is truly about, but my understanding is that nobody's going to open the bottom of the silo of cases in the Court of Session and they're suddenly going to descend on the Sheriff Court. After the bill becomes law, if it does become law, then cases will start in the Sheriff Court, and they will be there'll be a gradual build-up of the volume. So it won't be, as I call it, a tsunami of work that's going to descend on the Sheriff Court.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. I'll take Roderick, followed by John Finney, please, Roderick.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Montgomery, last week we heard evidence from Ronnie Conway of the Association of Personal Injury Lawyers and indeed from Robert Milligan QC just in relation to the financial memorandum and the figure of a saving of $1.2 million, 50% of expenditure. Mr. Milligan suggested 85% of legal aid funding is recovered by the government, so it does not spend that money. Secondly, legal aid is very seldom allowed in anything other than the most serious personal injury cases. I don't see why that will change. 50% saving is anticipated. I don't know where that 50% figure comes from. Mr. Conway said it was illusory and wrong. Can you perhaps just expand on
that? I have no idea what the 50% for that comes from.
50% of expenditure on council, I think.
Sorry?
50% of expenditure on council, I think, based on a 2012. It's paragraph 97 of the financial memorandum. The saving of 1.2 million.
Well, I think there are a number of misunderstandings there, and we've submitted further information for the Finance Committee. This is very, very complex for a range of reasons. Firstly, these kind of cases can take years and years. We still have cases that are on the go just now that are 10 years plus old. So we've had to take a view as to what the population of cases that we're looking at. Recoveries in cases.
It's 10 years.
Sorry?
What kind of case without, if it's in
reparation.
The public domain, a reparation that's taking 10 years?
Yeah,
perhaps we need better case management in the courts.
So absolutely, that's why the proposals that we're seeing we support wholeheartedly. There's a whole range of reasons, but in terms of the facts of the matter, we are paying cases now that we granted 10 years ago and have taken that length of time to get through the courts. For reparation and personal injury, the average is about 4 to 5 years. From the time that we grant and then start paying solicitors and advocates for cases, so, for example, for advocates, we pay every 6 months a dollar of money based on what they've done. And we can be doing that for many years before the case ends. And if it's successful, we then may get our money back, depending on the circumstances of the party that's lost. But we will make substantial savings for the cases that move down to the Sheriff Court, which don't require counsel, where currently we are paying all these amounts every 6 months for the next 4 or 5 years. Yes, we win a lot of the cases, or the cases we support are won, but there's an awful lot of cases that are not won. We've just had two in the last couple of weeks where, although when we were granted, it was on the basis that there were very good prospects of success, they were lost, and between the two cases, there'll be £300,000 that we will be paying out. Now, that's just two very recently. In any year, we can pay very substantial amounts of money out on cases that are lost. I sympathise with Ronnie Cornway and his colleagues in Naples trying to work out how these bits of money fit together. What I'm saying is this is very, very complex to estimate. And what we've said is we think the levels of savings will be in the order of 800,000 to 1.2 million, depending on the population of cases that come through. But we will, without any doubt, there must be savings, because if you take a significant number of cases out of the Court of Session and they do not require counsel in the future, then, quite frankly, we will save money.
Surely that's comparing apples with pears. What you need to do is to compare an identical case run by counsel with one run by the solicitor in the future.
Sorry.
But because just because it's in a different court doesn't necessarily make it cheaper. It depends on the hourly rate that's being paid to solicitors as opposed to counsel.
Well, yeah. For a start, in Court of Session, we'll be paying for at least two people. One will be an advocate and one will be a solicitor. Sometimes it's more than one advocate. In the Sheriff Court, and many of the cases that are currently done at these higher value are done by solicitors, we will be paying for the solicitor, not someone else.
Yeah, that depends on the rate that you're paying the solicitor as opposed to the rate that would be paid to counsel.
We pay counsel, senior counsel, including VAT, about £1,800 a day in the Court of Session. Solicitors are paid for non-advocate or advocacy work about £58 an hour. They're paid in different ways, and the comparison is not that easy.
It's sanctioned for senior counsel. You can't just get senior
no,
counsel.
No, but junior counsel you have in every case in the Court of Session. And that
I understand that. You know, I did it myself, yeah. But you don't just get a senior, you don't just get a QC on a request to the legal aid.
Already was talking about a comparison of rates.
Yes.
Where we've got senior counsel, it'll be about £1,800 a day. Junior counsel is about £1,300 a day in the Court of Session. We pay less for counsel in the Sheriff Court, where we have them. The difference is only about 10%.
That's my point. It's apples and apples, not apples and pears.
Well, no, they're apples and apples, because if you've got a case that has one person involved taking it through, the solicitor, compared to another case currently where we've got a solicitor and junior counsel in the Court of Session, identical cases, we will save a substantial amount of money on the basis that they're both done properly, because we're paying for a few fewer people to do them. That said, a lot of those cases are won, and if we get recoveries, then there'll be no cost to us. But there's still a lot of cases that cost us a lot of money. Sheriff Court cases and the averages are difficult to compare, but in reparation and personal injury, the average cost in the Court of Session is £30,000 to £40,000. In the Sheriff Court, you're talking about £4,000 to £8,000. You have to be careful with those comparisons, and I say that, but that's the reality. Sheriff Court cases cost us way less money.
Okay, there's some further information you gave to the Finance Committee on this point. But
we submitted further information, because we revisited the figures.
You're still adhering to a possible saving of up to 1.2 million, are you?
Over time, and taking account of the differences in how cases are handled in the Sheriff Court and the Court of Session, we've said a range of between 800,000 and 1.2 million. I don't think that's miles away. In fact, most of the figures we put into the financial memorandum, we've erred on understating savings. So, for example, we've put nothing in for what we think the benefits of case management, judicial specialisation, because they're too difficult to estimate. We believe they will significantly reduce the cost. The other thing I probably should say is I think there was a risk that Ronnie Conway and colleagues, and I think this was partly with the way the wording of the FM went, thought we were only talking about personal injury cases. We're not. we're talking about personal injury and reparation and the other cases that will go down to the Sheriff Court on the basis of these proposals. And that gives you a much bigger population of cases where the 800 to 1.2 million may come from. But I think we've made very clear, none of these are simple things to estimate. But we will save money.
Okay, thank you.
John Finney, followed by Margaret.
Thank you, Convener. Some questions for yourself, Mr McQueen, there about the financial statement, if I may. We know in the policy memorandum it talks about the reforms intended to modernise and enhance the efficiency, and at paragraph 39 it states that the Scottish Court Service have estimated a potential saving of £163 for every day where a summoned sheriff can be used in lieu of a sheriff. Is it projected ahead how these savings would be correlate to sheriffs leaving? And how these savings? I mean, one sheriff leaves this year, yeah, replaced by somebody sheriff, that's £163 every day, if you follow where I'm going with that.
Yeah,
I mean, essentially, what we're saying is that in terms of the the overall saving, and this will be a saving largely to the Scottish Government, in terms of judicial costs, we reckon that over the full time it will be about £1.2 million. In terms of what that's going to look like every year, our anticipation is it will be round about £200,000 a year as the pool starts to build up and you move between sheriffs and summary sheriffs. Now, quite clearly, that is tied into retirement profiles, and quite clearly that can change on a year-by-year basis. But we are quite clear that once we get to the end of it, the figure in terms of the totality saving the Scottish Government will be around about £1.2 million, and depending on the change period within that, and I say roughly at £200,000 a year, is the best estimate. Now, I suspect you're going to tell me this isn't quite your area here, but the Scottish Government has a policy of no compulsory redundancies. Are you aware of any plans for early packages, encouragement for sheriffs to leave?
I think we can I think we can safely say none whatsoever.
Good.
I think under terms of appointment of the judiciary, that is not something that is possible or feasible.
Okay. So it doesn't do any harm to have that in the record, I don't think. Further costs in the future on how further deployment of Shrieble resources is determined is another phrase that's used there. And I wonder, in relation to honorary sheriffs, where the financial memorandum tells us in the longer term it's expected that part-time sheriffs and part-time summary sheriffs supported by technology will be able to cover this work with minimal effect on costs. Now, we heard previously, I think it was 1 in 4 weeks, perhaps 1 in 3, that a sheriff from Paisley went to Campbellton to undertake the duties there. Can you explain how the duties that take place these 3 or 4 weeks are going to be dealt with by part-time sheriffs, part-time...
I think it's worth saying, first of all, that this is very much in the long term. So there's going to be no immediate rush at all to look to move on the sheriffs out. They provide a very valuable role, and particularly a valuable role in our rural communities in terms of dealing with the emergency business when it arrives and there's not a sheriff in those areas. I think what is recognised in terms of the reforms is that certainly the view of the Lord President, the view of the Scottish Government, is that we want to make sure that in terms of all cases we have properly qualified and properly trained judiciary in place. I think that's a reasonable starting point to make. I think what we have said is that as we move forward with technology, and admittedly that could be 4 or 5 years further down the road, will there be more opportunities for the types of work that are carried out by honorary sheriffs to be actually done by technology instead? Now, one of the predominant areas that they're using is in terms of custody cases in local areas. With the change, if it comes through in terms of the Criminal Justice Bill, that will give us the opportunity now to use first callings in custody cases to do them by video conference. So we're working with Police Scotland and Crown at the moment in terms of, well, what could that look like in the future? So we could see a position in a number of years' times where actually for a lot of this routine emergency-type business, which is about first callings that honorary sheriffs do, we actually have a different way and a more effective way of doing that business anyway. Until such time as we have those facilities in place, until such time as they are proven, we will continue to use the very valued honorary sheriffs that we currently have in place at the moment, and there's no intention to be different. Now, Vary, from a judicial perspective, if you've got any...
Honorary sheriffs... in my sheriffdom, all of the honorary sheriffs are either legally qualified or one in the past sat as chairman of the Westminster Magistrates. Honorary sheriffs don't tend to be used in my sheriffdom, but I know that they are in the more remote rural communities where it's essential to have somebody on hand to deal with very urgent business, such as an urgent custody or the granting of a warrant. So it is not a problem in my area. Honorary sheriffs become honorary sheriffs because they've done significant public service, either as a usually a procurator fiscal, a sheriff, or in another area, and it's simply recognition of that. I think the last time an honorary sheriff was used in Lothian and Borders was during the very bad winter of 2010, when somebody had to struggle to Selkirk or Peebles to deal with a custody, although I don't know how the prisoner got there either, but that is it. So it's horses for courses. It's not going to have a great impact on Lothian and Borders, but it will have an impact on other sheriffdoms. What I would like to say is that introducing a new level of judiciary, the summary sheriff, is really pretty groundbreaking, because I can't remember the last time a new level of judiciary was introduced even south of the border. So it's a huge opportunity to set the parameters, get people with varied skill sets, and the nature of their job will be much more flexible, and indeed there may be a peripatetic type of responsibility if a summary sheriff has a particular skill, particularly in civil matters. He might not need to sit all week. He or she might not need to sit all week in one area, but may travel and deploy his or her skills in different courts on different days. So that is another area where the new level of judiciary will, I think, give the system a lot more flexibility.
Can I ask how advanced discussions have been on the notion of peripatetic sheriffs?
This is work that is being discussed. It's in the end of the day for the Judicial Appointments Board to select sheriffs, but obviously the Judicial Appointments Board will need to know what the job spec is, and there will be a requirement for people clearly to do the generalist work of summary crime and civil business. But as we said in the review, it is an opportunity to get people with particular skills, people who have dealt with clients all their working life, solicitors perhaps, who are very experienced, who have an entire career of sorting out their clients' problems. And these very skills will be very important, I think, in the simple procedure in consumer and other cases where they will sort out the problem.
I'm looking for the reference, and I suspect, oh, in fact, I have found it, yeah. Section 28 reenacts the 71 Act, we're told here, and gives the Sheriff principal power to order to prescribe where and when Sheriff courts will sit and the descriptions of business to dispose of those of at those sittings. So there's discretion at the moment, and that's reinforced by this legislation to facilitate this sort of peripatetic approach and measures of specialism as well.
Yes, indeed, yes. At the present time, it is not particularly efficient to have a sheriff going to a court to do part of a morning's business and then can't be deployed for the rest of the day, for example. So it has to be melded with an efficient approach, and it is thought that there might be more part-time appointments in the summary sheriff bench, and that would make it a lot more flexible.
Of course, there's great encouragement for collaborative working across the public sector, mm-hmm. and I noticed, Mr. McQueen, you said in relation to arrangements that you would be in discussions with Police Scotland about the technology that would be used. That presumably, Sheriff Principal, would extend to using other public sector facilities, because clearly no one wants to inconvenience a sheriff, but one sheriff driving about a car rather than a whole load of other public officials. There has to be a cost to the public purse. Is there any examination across budget heads so that people aren't operating in silos, as was commended by the Christie Commission?
I think the object of the reforms is also not to bring people to court too often. I think we bring people to court too frequently, and we don't sometimes achieve the object. So bringing people to court when they're needed, and otherwise using technology. For example, the parallel jurisdiction and family work between the summary sheriff and the sheriff will work, I'm sure, with practice directions and with technology. If, for example, the court in Jedburgh has a family case and they want the skill of the specialist family sheriff, there is no reason why the child welfare hearing can't be conducted by remote means between Edinburgh, where the family sheriff is situated, and the parties in a room or courtroom in Jedburgh.
Indeed, but
Highlands and islands in that question, give but it was lurking there.
There is, of course, no substitute for the whites of the eyes in these, you know, if it's one set of eyes that have to move to facilitate maybe a dozen folk. And moving to the Highlands and Islands, and in particular, the reference in the policy memorandum to the island communities, and I quote, "The provisions of the bill apply equally to all communities in Scotland." Now, we heard last week from Scottish Women's Aid the significant disadvantage there would be were a range of specialists to come in and you literally have the world on granny getting on a boat to go to Aberdeen to have the matter dealt with, or on a plane to Inverness, rather than have one individual going to meet the people. I think this is an opportunity. You say it is groundbreaking to see justice being taken to the people rather than the people going to justice. Would you agree with that?
That could be done in a variety of ways, and I think that is where I'm pleased to hear that money is to be spent on technology, because I think that is very much going to underpin the effectiveness of these reforms.
And just finally, if I may, then, Chair of Principal, and it's on the issue of clustering of cases. There's an opportunity with very modest, I would say, administrative arrangements to facilitate, for instance, a lot of courts having a day designated as a domestic abuse court. Domestic abuse courts conjure up for people visions of entire new structures, entire new buildings. Mm-hmm. This is about the administrative process, clustering cases, making it better for other agencies. Is that something that can be picked up and progressed as a matter of urgency?
Well, that happens at present. The important matters with domestic abuse is speed, support and advocacy. And at the present time, these cases tend to be, even in the larger courts, clustered into a particular day in order that the trained domestic abuse sheriffs can deal with them.
Well, I have to tell you, that's not the case in the Highlands and Islands.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would tend to agree with
John Finney. I mean, I think there will be cases, particularly in the more rural areas, maybe Highlands are maybe an example, where maybe as we move more towards specialism, there's perhaps more we can do to think about clustering on particular days. Okay. So it's certainly something we can look at, John.
That's appreciated. Thanks very much.
On the matter, just picking up on domestic abuse cases, I seem to recall last week the Scottish Women's Aid wanted these to be heard before the sheriff and not a summary sheriff, because they felt that sent a message as well about the seriousness with which the justice system took these cases. Did the panel have a view on that?
Day, it is about what the outcome is going to be, to make sure that the important ingredients that I've mentioned, which is dealing with them speedily so that special bail conditions are not separating families over long unless that's necessary, so that they have advocacy and that they are supported and that there are smart sentencing options. Now, if these are brought as summary cases, it is appropriate, in my view, that suitably trained summary sheriffs will deal with these and sentence these appropriately. Very often, the important message is about dealing with them swiftly and having the correct sentencing option. And that is usually a constructive sentencing option rather than necessarily imprisonment.
Does anybody else have a view on that? I thought I'd put you, because the Scottish Women's Aid certainly made a point. I wanted to ask, just on summary sheriffs again, would legal aid boards save money by cases going, civil cases going to the others, the lower level of sheriffs and to the other sheriffs?
That would depend on decisions taken on fee rates payable. And that's a matter for the Scottish Government, which obviously we will be discussing with them.
Maybe what I'm aiming at, of course, is that they oughtn't to go to a sheriff, a summary sheriff, for the reasons that it saves money.
That's not the issue. I mean, we'll have to look at changing fee rates for summary sheriff business.
On this scale, where are we on this business of changing fee rates? Because that seems to me relevant if the committee is considering what the motivation for it is.
That's an area of discussion that we and the government are having in early course. The bill will require, as we said in our written evidence, a number of changes to fees. Summary will require it, and some others, and we'll have to work out that in fairly early course.
Is that before the bill reaches stage three?
I can't say that the timing on that will be for Scottish Government.
No, but I'm sorry, but presume that the bill gets through by, I think the timetable is something at the end of June, isn't it, for stage three, if I'm correct? End of June, isn't it? Yes, it's the end of June is predicted for stage two. Stage three when, then? All right, I beg your pardon. And we're still in April Fool's Day and I'm scaring the horses. Mustn't do any more of that. No, that wasn't meant. Now, can I move on? Margaret, if you don't mind, I'll take John, who's not been in yet. John Pentland. Sandra is back with us and alive and well. And having a cup of tea, I hope, to be followed by John Pentland, then Christian, then Margaret. That's because you've not been in, right?
Just for the record, Mr. McQueen, what reassurance could you give to those people who have raised concerns with regards to the number of cases that's going to get into Sheriff Court, you know, to a court system that's already under extreme pressure and is creaking? What reassurance could you offer to them?
I mean, I think the assurance I can give, and I think it's going back on some of the things I said earlier on, is that in terms of physical capacity within the Sheriff Courts, that capacity is there and it's available. We don't have any major concerns about that. In terms of the business levels that will come potentially from the court recession if this bill goes ahead, we anticipate there will be something in the region of 2,700 cases that will come from the court recession. The bulk of those 2,000 will be personal injury cases, and our anticipation is that they will go into the specialist personal injury court, which will be set up separately and will be specifically resourced to deal with that business. So the level of cases to come to the sheriff court would actually be a very small number. If you just worked out on that arithmetic, it would be around 700. Equally, through time, as the specialist personal injury court becomes established, we actually might expect that some of the work currently in the sheriff courts may come into the specialist court, because the whole point is having about judicial specialism, access to early court diets for the business. So actually we would want that to become a place of choice for people in the future. So the level of business coming to the sheriff courts is very, very small. It's less than 3% of the current civil business that they are handling at the moment. And again, only about 2% of those cases actually go through to proof. So speaking on behalf of the court service, I know that views are shared by the Sheriff Principals and by the Lord President. We're absolutely confident about the impact on the Sheriff Court and the ability of the Sheriff Court to deal with that business.
And you won't anticipate then that this additional work will create further adjournments at court?
Not at all.
It's in writing now. It's on the record. Sandra, is that you finished, John?
Yeah.
Sandra.
Thank you very much, convener. Apologies to the panel. I think John had asked and asked the question that I was going to ask about specialised courts and the specialised injury court, what impact it would have. And I think Mr McQueen has answered that question. So,
I think there was an issue, wasn't there, Sandra, about health and safety issues in the Sheriff Court and the importance of counsel in these particular cases and concerns expressed by the previous panel last week, that the sheriffs might not be prepared to sanction council. There will be all kinds of issues about sanctioning for expenses and so on. I just put that to you as an issue which might also involve legal aid board, in particular health and safety cases, which are obviously a personal injury. Is that what you... Because I thought you...
Well, actually, it was the first one about the specialisation and obviously the impact in the courts, and I thought someone else had maybe asked that then. I was going to ask about the employment court, but I didn't know if that was relevant or not.
So any comments on these? If you've had an opportunity to see the evidence we had last week.
Could I maybe mention a little about the specialised specialisation and the specialised court? The Civil Justice Council are working on a pre-action protocol and whether that should be made compulsory in personal injury cases. At the present time, there's a voluntary pre-action protocol, and I'm sure you've heard about it because you've heard a lot about personal injury. But that is a very important matter because, again, many of the objects of reform is to enhance settlement, to underpin that compromise can be better than contest. And that is a worthy object. Now, I think after the work is done by the Personal Injury Subcommittee, obviously the Civil Justice Council will consider the matter of making compulsory the pre-action protocol. Now, that should also have an effect on the number of cases coming into the specialised personal injury court. And if I can see from personal experience in my past life as a solicitor dealing with personal injury cases, that these cases are in the main raised to be settled. And that is clear from the fact that very few cases proceed to a full-blown hearing, a very, very small number. So that is a very important aspect. The other thing I would like to reassure the committee about is the rules of court applying to personal injury cases are the same in the Court of Session, the Sheriff Court, and also the present summary cause procedure. And it is a framework or timetable that the parties have to adhere to. So they know what the parameters are. They get the proof date in the Sheriff Court once the defences are lodged. And I'm concerned to hear that cases are taking up to 4 years, because these should be dealt with within a year, or roughly that sort of period. And basically what the sheriffs will do is that they will manage these cases, and if somebody trips up at one of the stages, then that is when the sheriff will become involved. And obviously the sheriffs will then deal with any cases that do have to go to a contested hearing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
No, nobody else has indicated.
I just wanted to thank for the clarification, because obviously we'll be hearing more evidence from the S2EC and others in regard to personal injury and obviously employment law as well. But I'm appreciative of the clarification of that.
To reassure that, that there's no agenda or object in the review to downgrade personal injury, quite the opposite. It's to have appropriate resources. It's a very important area. I dealt with pursuers personal injury litigation as a solicitor. And there's also no agenda to exclude counsel where counsel is required. Sheriffs, I am sure, will want to be well addressed by both solicitors and counsel, and they will deal with their discretionary decision on sanction of counsel appropriately. It is also important to recognise that personal injury solicitors do tend to be specialists in this area.
In terms of sanction for counsel, what we do is different. The sheriff is deciding whether they would allow counsel in the event the one party loses, and they will have to pick up the cost. We will take decisions on granting sanction for counsel if we believe the assisted person requires it. We do grant sanction for counsel in the Sheriff Court. where the case warrants it, where it's appropriate, and we will continue to do that. But the difference with the current system is if it's in the court of session, then junior counsel is automatically available, whether the court, the case requires that. In the sheriff court, it will be down to the submission by the solicitor, often aided by counsel, to say this case needs it because it's complex and difficult, and we will grant those.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Moving on, I have Christian, then Margaret, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. Always good afternoon now. I just have a question for Sheriff Principal Stephen regarding the vision of Lord Gill on his reviews for future court procedure, and particularly, I wanted to know, what about the small claims procedure courts? Are they working for unrepresented litigants just now? Is it one of the views of Lord Gill review to transform the way court procedures at this level are dealt with?
Yes, I think I can comment on that. I think you probably heard from the sheriffs not so long ago, and there are different approaches to these small claims. Some sheriffs are more comfortable and more skilled than others at intervening, almost mediating, and you know, getting parties to speak to each other. Very often getting them to speak at all to each other is very difficult. What the review board thought was important is that the new level of judiciary, the summary sheriff, this would be the main and an important part of their civil jurisdiction. So they would bring a different mindset. You have to bear in mind that sheriffs have this huge civil jurisdiction. They can be doing cases in 1 week involving £100 and also in the same week involving several million pounds. And it involves different skills and different approaches. The lower value cases are very much suitable for a more mediatory interventionist approach. So it was considered that this would be a very good opportunity to have summary sheriffs with these very skills and that they would treat this as the important and major part of their jurisdiction, and they would bring a different approach to these cases.
Approach increase the number of litigants coming without any representation? And would that be seen as access to justice?
Well, indeed, there are very many litigants or party litigants or litigants in person, as they're called in England, coming to the court in these cases. And it's true to say that, you know, when a sheriff sees somebody coming with the full Tesco bag, you know, sometimes they think, oh, gosh, you know, this is good to be.
Politicians have the same. When two Tesco bags come and somebody says, I must take you back 10 years.
Exactly.
You know, no, I'm not going back 10 years.
And very often people, when they represent themselves, yes, are far too close to the issue.
Yes.
And this is for the sheriff then to really take an objective approach, but to try and get to the root of the problem. And sometimes have to explain that even if you prove what you want to prove, you're not going to achieve the remedy that you're seeking. So it is very important, and sheriffs have to be able to deal with these cases, and they can be quite time-consuming. So we think it would be a very good idea that they become a specialised part of the summary sheriff's jurisdiction.
What kind of insurance can you... You talked about training for sheriffs. What other insurance can you give to organisations like Citizens Advice Scotland, and which would ask for a genuine support for those people representing themselves?
Well, I think what is important, and this is mentioned in the review, and I think it's generally accepted that in-court mediation is very important. That is taking the case out of the court for a spell and having trained mediators get the parties together. Also, in-court advice, and perhaps Lindsay will be able to say a little more about that. but also public legal education. I think this is all part of the proposal that there be better information on the website, guidance issued so that the litigants can follow the procedure. It is also an important duty of the Civil Justice Council to ensure that the rules which will be made as a priority are apt for that procedure and for party litigants.
Yes, Mr. Montgomery.
Just picking up on that point, we fund a range of projects around the country to help provide assistance to people to resolve cases. In fact, the whole purpose of our grant funding, a large purpose of it, is to enable people to solve things before they become problems that need to go into court. We also fund the in-court advice that's been in Edinburgh for a long time, and a number of other projects as well. It perhaps is also important to remember, for small claims, legal aid is not available just now, and this doesn't change that. So this is trying to find ways of giving people support at court, or hopefully before court, to find ways to resolve these matters.
If a small claim, however, becomes complex, with some complex principle of law, because it can and might happen, then I take it then it's remitted elsewhere and legal aid is then available. If there's some point of law that maybe arises, even in a low level of cost.
If it comes out of small claims and is then currently either summary or ordinary, then legal aid can be available.
Yeah. Now, I have Margaret, and then I'm not going to say anything else in case I say that's the last question. John, you're giving me that look, Margaret.
Sheriff Princess Stephen, since you raised the issue of pre-action protocol, I wonder if you'd like to take the opportunity to comment on the evidence we heard from the last panel, that the 3 months time limit for application for judicial review would lead to a rush to get to court and pre-action protocol would not be used.
Judicial review is not really my billet, but I can say that the proposal, I think, probably emanated from taking a comparative approach to how matters are dealt with in England and Wales, and also having some sort of gatekeeping function, which is the permission stage. I believe there is a pre-action protocol in England. I don't know anything about how that operates. The pre-action protocol that the Civil Justice Council are currently considering relates to personal injury cases, but there are other protocols, including housing cases, which will eventually be for the summary sheriff, but these are already in place. I accept that 3 months is a potentially a tight timescale, but I have no direct experience of dealing with judicial review because it's a court of session.
I appreciate you're here as a member of the Scottish Civil Justice Council, not as a member primarily of the Gill Review today. Could I ask just a final...
No, Mr. Montgomery wants to come in on that question.
If I may. Yeah. From what we found out from what's happening in England and Wales, they do have a pre-action protocol, but it's not mandatory. However, if parties don't abide by it, then the court will have regard to that when they take decisions on expenses. Pre-action protocols, and in our evidence, we proposed that there should be one in judicial review, and I was glad to hear Tony Kelly supporting the same point of view earlier. It would be far better if the disagreement over whatever public body's decision it is can be resolved without having to go into court. And we think a pre-action protocol in that context would be very helpful. There will still be cases where no agreement will be reached, and what is crucial is that there are arrangements available to ensure that these can be taken forward.
I don't think there was any dubiety about that. The point was the 3 months limit was so short that it would mean you just go to court automatically to protect your position rather than look at trying to get some form of pre-action.
And if there's a pre-action protocol, that will enhance the chances of people doing that, what might need to be thought about is whether something in the bill should reflect the fact that there should be a pre-action protocol, and that's something I think there needs to be further consideration to, because if that is there, you can take the view as to whether the 3 months starts after that or runs as it does in England and Wales at the same time as the 3 months, and those will give you different positions.
Can I ask you, because it's been raised by a number of people we've taken evidence from, the 3 month time limit for judicial review is thought to be too short for SLAB to be able to consider legal aid applications?
We don't think it would be. 3 months will be tight, and no messing about that, for all of us. But there are a number of safeguards which I think can work to ensure that people are able to at least get the legal aid cover in place. If we get, I mean, I think something like 80% of the applications we get for judicial review are for asylum or immigration. About 60% of those that we grant for judicial review are for asylum and immigration. And those tend to be a continuing process. They've been elsewhere in the system, and then judicial review is just the final stage of that. So it's not a surprise to anyone in those cases. Solicitors use what's called special urgency in huge numbers every year for a whole range of types of case. And for last year, there were about 11,000 of them. 8,500 of these were where the solicitor can act without coming near us to protect the client's position, and that includes putting in submissions where there is time bar. So it happens in current cases where there's a 3 year or a 5 year maximum period. And it's amazing how many cases, even although the person's got 3 or 5 years, come in at the last stage. So the solicitor is able to use special urgency, and that will include getting the petition into court. In the 3 month period, if we get them early and the solicitor's given us all the information we require, we will take a decision, and if it meets the statutory tests, we will grant. There was some evidence given to you that we would wait until the petition stage. We don't think we would be doing that. If there's enough to meet the statutory tests, we will grant that case. If they come late in the day within the 3 month period, or they've not given us enough information and we've gone back to them, then they're able to use special urgency to get the petition into court and to protect the client's interests. It will mean that we will be prioritising judicial review applications to make sure there's no delay for us. Secondly, we will want to do quite a lot of work with the profession in order to provide much fuller guidance on what we need to make a judicial review application successful. Currently, we have to return or continue an awful lot of these, and then we grant them on review. We would like to be able to grant them by getting all the necessary information first time, and that benefits everybody involved, including the lawyers, the clients, and the courts. And by doing that, we think we can make this process much, much more manageable. It creates a discipline for us all, and that will be a challenge. But in terms of if that proposal goes ahead, we don't believe it will cause access to justice problems.
I mean, I'm fish out of water a bit with this, but I would think there must be language difficulties, let alone not knowing the law, which, you know, we all say that ignorance of the law is no defence, but my goodness, most people are ignorant of lots of law. Certainly if you're an asylum seeker and you're in a foreign country and there are all kinds of pressures and chaos on you and language difficulties. I'm just surprised because you're saying, you know, I would have thought 3 months, a big difference between 3 months and 3 years, which you did the equivalent for PI. And the other point that you made is that you say we prioritise these applications. What would the knock-on effect therefore be to other emergency applications coming in?
Well, we deal with special urgency cases in an average of 1.1 days. We are able to deal with those. Full applications, because we have to have a period.
But you did say you'd prioritise. So if you're prioritising, you're taking that category and moving the head of this queue, but so there must be a knock-on effect.
No, we're talking about we get 500 or so applications a year. 80% of those are asylum and immigration, which, as was said in the earlier session, have the particular way. And in all these cases, there will already be a solicitor, or virtually all, there will always be already be a solicitor involved in the case. The judicial review is the final part of quite can often be a long process. The issue will not be new in those cases. You then have cases against Scottish ministers, often for prisoners, and quite often for those, there will already have been some sort of case involved. That doesn't apply in all areas, and the point made about the environmental ones, they're slightly different there. But for the large number or large percentage of what is not a huge number of applications, I mean, we deal with 20,000 or 22,000 civil legal aid applications every year and a huge number of ancillary ones, that 500 is not difficult to prioritise.
So it's not a problem. The issue of the 3 months is of no concern to SLAP.
No, what we're saying is it will cause us to change how we do things, get better guidance and help get these things right first time. But if Parliament at the end of the day goes for 3 months, what I'm saying is I don't believe that in itself will not be able to be met fully by the legal aid system.
Can I take Roderick, your last?
Yeah. Just a small point, Mr. McQueen. The 700 cases, approximately non-personal injury cases, to transfer from the Court of Session to Sheriff Courts. Have we got any kind of knowledge as to the geographic spread of those cases?
I don't have that with me today, but if it's possible or helpful, if I could provide it to you.
Helpful.
I say, but it is bearing in mind that irrespective, it's less than 3% of the Sheriff Court business. Now, what we have anticipated is that basically it will fall where population is. So, you know, the larger courts in terms of Edinburgh and Glasgow will take their bigger share of them. But I say, if it would be helpful to try to have a snapshot of that, then we're happy to try and provide that. But it will follow the pretty much the distribution of the court network we have.
Okay, that would be helpful. Yeah.
Right, that concludes the evidence session. I thank the panel very much, and we're finished with that, and we now we've agreed to go into private session, so we're moving into private session. I ask the public area please to clear as well. Thank you.